Got a really interesting program for you today. Let's find out who we're talking to. You're unbelievable. Well, today on Unbelievable, we're talking about why we left Mormonism, speaking to two former members of the Church of Latter-day Saints, Lynn Wilder and Corey Miller. In conversation today with a Mormon, James Holt. Corey Miller and Lynn Wilder are contributors to a new book, Leaving Mormonism, Why Four Scholars Changed Their Minds. They'll be telling their stories and engaging with James, a UK Mormon involved in academic research with the LDS Church. Well, we're going to hear the concerns Corey has over the way Mormons invest in importance in testimony, and Lynn's case was sparked by concerns over the Mormon history on polygamy and racism, but ultimately that she came to read the Bible and didn't believe that Mormonism matched the biblical Jesus. And of course we'll hear what James has to say in response to them both. So it's great to have everyone joining me on the show today via phone and via Skype and all kinds of ways. We're all in different parts of the world, but managing to bring it together for an edition of Unbelievable today. Before we come to James, who's been on the show before, let's talk to Lynn and Corey. First of all, Lynn, welcome along to the programme. In fact, back to the programme. I was able to be with you when you were in the UK a couple of years ago. You've obviously told your story before, but tell us a little bit about this book and some of the other stories that are going to be involved when it releases.
I find this absolutely fascinating. I never expected to be at this point in my life. In 2006, I was challenged to read the Bible, and I didn't trust the Bible as a Mormon. I trust to the Book of Mormon better. So I decided I would just, in order to find truth, the seed of truth, I would go to the Book of Mormon and read the red letter words of Christ. Of course, there aren't any red letters in Mormon scripture. And I realized there weren't any of those in the Book of Mormon, except in one small place in 3rd Nephi, where Jesus supposedly visited the people in the Book of Mormon. And what Jesus spoke to them was the Beatitudes right out of Matthew 5. And I remember thinking, wow, I guess if I want truth from the mouth of Jesus, I'm going to have to go to the New Testament. Well, I have a son. All three of our sons had served Mormon missions. When our third son was on his Mormon mission, he was challenged to read the Bible by a Baptist pastor he encountered. So he had read the New Testament a dozen times during his mission, and he then reached back and challenged his parents to read the Bible with no preconceived notions and see what we thought. So I was talking to a religion professor friend of mine at Brigham Young. I was a tenured professor at Brigham Young at the time. And he said, well, if you want to hear the words of Jesus, why don't you try some of the newer versions of the Bible? And I went, there are other versions of the Bible? Because, of course, Mormons just use the King James Version. And so someone gave me an NIV, and I began to read the words of Jesus, and I started in the book of John. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And I went, Jesus wasn't God from the beginning. He worked his way to Godhood. That's what I had been taught for 30 years in Mormonism. And reading the Bible then just rocked my doctrinal basis of Mormonism, because this was not the same gospel. In fact, right there in the first verse I read, it's like, this is not the same Jesus. I eventually realized this is not the same God the Father. And this is not the same way to salvation. So we've got a serious conundrum here.
And before we hear from Corey, you at this point, at the point that you actually left the Mormon Church eventually, Lynn, were a professor at Brigham Young University working in areas of cultural diversity and things. So this was, you know, in your case, a somewhat high profile person choosing to leave the faith eventually.
Yes, there was quite a lash back from people that I knew when I left the faith. One of the things that often happens in Mormonism is you lose your friends. I lost 30 years of friends. One of the temple recommend questions, in order to be worthy enough to enter a temple, they actually ask Mormons whether they affiliate with an individual who believes something that's opposite the church. And so affiliating with someone like me, although it doesn't usually make people lose their worthiness, their temple recommends, can. So all of a sudden, everyone I knew, everything I knew kind of evaporated, disappeared.
We're going to hear more of your story as you interact with James Holt, our Mormon guest on the program today, shortly. But before we do that, let's also hear from Corey, who's one of the other contributors to this book, Leaving Mormonism. Corey, you also have a story of leaving Mormonism. We'll get to it when we come to you later on in the program and your story. Just tell us all briefly, right, though, about what other stories, if people go and get the book, they'll find in this particular volume.
Sure. There are four of us in the volume, and two were born into Mormonism with an ancestral background. Two were converts into Mormonism. All have been or are professors in biblical studies, philosophy, comparative religions, physics, or education. And so you'll get all of our stories, our testimonies, which is sort of Mormon language and spiritual exercises there, but also our particular reasons. Some of those come from our particular fields, but sometimes we branch outside of our fields because they are, after all, our stories and our own reasons for why we left Mormonism to pursue Jesus faithfully.
And as I understand it, you have some ancestral connection indeed to someone who knew Joseph Smith, the founder of Mormonism.
Right. My ancestry, as some of my family say, I've got healthy stock, and that's not just because my ancestor had five wives and 36 children, of which I'm a descendant, but goes all the way back to Joseph Smith himself in terms of relation. My ancestor was one of his bodyguards, and his father was a family friend of one of the highest ranking Mormons to ever defect from Mormonism in the first presidency. Because Joseph Smith had courted his wife as one of the wives that Joseph Smith desired, whose husband was still living at the time, William Law. So it goes back to the first decade of the launching of Mormonism.
Well, look, we'll hear more of your story in a moment. Let me also welcome to the program James Holt, who's here as a Mormon guest. It is a bit two against one today, James, but we're going to try and make sure you've got just as much airtime as both Lynn and Corey on today's program. Tell us a little bit about yourself, James. You've been on the show before, but remind us, you live obviously here in the UK. Were you a convert to the Church of Latter-day Saints yourself, or born into it?
I was a convert, yes, about the age of 14 or 15. I'd been a nominal Christian through my life, but then when I was about 14 or 15, as I was searching for God and my relationship with him, I found Christ through the church. That's probably nearly 30 years ago now, giving away my age a little bit.
Well, that's fine. I mean, you've obviously embraced that then as an adult, and obviously committed to it today. Do you hear stories, though, like Lynn's, like Corey's and others, of people who are leaving the faith? I've heard other people talking about a sort of an exodus almost from the Mormon church, but is that an over-exaggeration? What have you heard is happening on that front?
I've not seen an exodus, but from my own experience, I have had some very close friends recently who have left for different reasons and who are not at church anymore. And, I mean, listening to Lynn's story, they're still my friends, and I have no problem associating with them, spending time with them, those different types of things. But I guess living in the UK, it would be very difficult to only associate with Mormons anyway. But it's my responsibility to, well, they're my friends first and foremost, and so we still maintain those relationships. But probably for similar reasons to, we'll hear from Lynn and from Corey, they've decided not to be at church. I wouldn't call it an exodus, but there have been people who have left, yes.
In Lynn and Corey's case, they've obviously embraced what they believe is biblical Christianity. Not every Mormon who rejects the Mormon church, though, does. There are, of course, those who reject faith altogether. I don't know if that's the experience you've been seeing in those who do ultimately reject it.
Yes, probably the the majority of people, that's not so, but most of the people that I can think of in my own experience haven't left to embrace another form of Christianity or another religion. They've, in fact, probably the person closest to me has just said, I just don't believe in anything anymore. So it's more to an agnosticism or to an atheism rather than to another form of Christianity.
Right.
So it differs and from person to person, really, depending on what their reasons are and what their thought processes are, really.
Today, we're discussing why we left Mormonism. Corey Miller and Lynn Wilder are contributors to a new book titled Leaving Mormonism. They're going to be telling their stories and engaging with James Holt, a UK Mormon, on the show today. Crossing back to you, Lynn, let's start again with your story. You obviously, you know, we can't tell the full story here, but it was partly through your son who when he went away on the missionary trip that most, you know, young Mormons are involved in, came back actually having become convinced actually that Mormonism wasn't the truth. You tell that whole story, you tell how you yourself wrestled with various issues over a couple of years period. Interestingly, the thing that started you on your down journey doubting Mormonism was actually some of the practices of Mormonism in terms of polygamy and even racism at some level in the past. But those weren't the things that actually tipped you over the edge as such, were they?
No, because at the time, even though I was aware that the founder of Mormonism, Joseph Smith, had practiced polygamy, I wasn't aware that he had married 11 women who had been married to other men when he took them as their wives. I didn't realize he'd married a girl as young as 14. And as far as the racism went, I didn't realize the racism was right in Mormon scripture. 26 scriptures that say that dark skin is a curse. It even still says in the Book of Mormon that when the Lamanites, the unrighteous ones, joined the righteous ones, the Nephites, that their skin turned from dark to light. So even though those things aided me, until I began to read the Bible and actually open my mind to investigating whether Mormonism was actually true, I didn't know how really bad the root of polygamy and racism were. But certainly God had softened my heart on those two issues. You know, there's only so much you can ignore for so long. Found a very different gospel in the Bible. It rocked my world, and this God was so much bigger. Let me give you an example. The God of Mormonism has a body of flesh and bone. He's a material being. I now see that as limiting him. He's not omnipresent. Therefore, he can't hear everyone's prayers at once. These things started becoming clear to me as I read the Bible. But the God of the Bible is spirit. He's omnipresent. He's omnipotent. He's omniscient. And to me, that was a much bigger God. And then as I began to believe in this God, walk with this God, and trust this God, wow, things happened that had never happened to me before.
Let me toss this back to you at this point, James. Couple of issues just that start out with there. When I guess this was going back a while, perhaps before the internet sort of put these things at everyone's fingertips quite so readily. But Lynn said she wasn't aware at the time of some of the what she perceived as racism in the Book of Mormon and polygamy and Joseph Smith's wives, etc. Should we start there? Because to what extent is this troubling for your average Mormon today? Or do you think these issues have been dealt with satisfactorily by the Mormon Church today?
I mean, I can only speak as an individual, but looking at those issues, those are issues that people face because they are within the history of the Church and everything else. So they are things that people are aware of, and I think the Church has done a lot over the last couple, few years to try and address some of the issues and be more transparent with those things. I mean, those are things that from an early time within the Church I was aware of and everything else. So they'd never, for me, they'd never been hidden or they weren't new, they want new information at certain points. But certainly over the last couple of years, the church has tried to address those issues in different ways to explain some of those things, or perhaps talk about them in different ways, and other things like that.
And what about this issue of the idea that, that God, in the Mormon view, is sort of limited in a sort of flesh and bone type God rather than a God who is spirit and everywhere? Does that work? Does that kind of ring any bells for you, James?
The idea that God has a body of flesh and bone, yes, definitely. It's within Mormon scripture. It's within the Doctrine and Covenants that the Father has a body of flesh and bone, certainly. But I wouldn't see that as limiting God. I would still see him as omnipotent. I would still see him as omnipresent, and he's able to do that through the light of Christ and everything else. He can still hear my prayers, and certainly I feel that my prayers are answered and my prayers are listened to. And so I don't see it in any way as limiting him, but he functions in that particular way as he is. And so it doesn't lessen my relationship with him. It doesn't lessen the awe within which I hold him.
This may be quite surprising for some listeners, though, who had assumed when a Mormon talks about God, they sort of essentially mean the same sort of God that an average Christian means. But is this a God then who is embodied, a God who is literally somewhere in the universe in that sense? They live somewhere. It's a kind of that kind of a physical manifestation.
I don't know where he lives. I don't know that he's within the universe. I would. There are obviously multiple and millions of universes, I would assume. So as to his location, but he is, I suppose, outside of the realm that we understand. But yes, that he has that physical embodiment. And I think that's one of the issues, I think, in any interfaith, interreligious discussion. Wittgenstein talked about language games, didn't he? That sometimes when I say I believe Jesus is the Son of God, it's very different to what others mean. And so we use the same language, but sometimes it kind of has different meanings behind that. So when I say I believe in God, you're quite right. I envisage someone very different to, for example, a Catholic or to any perhaps other form of Christian as well.
Lynn, any response to that? And let's also move on to the subject of why you saw the biblical Jesus as so different to the Jesus represented in Mormonism as well.
My response to that actually comes from the Mormon temple. My husband and I worked in the Chicago temple for 10 years, and so I'm well aware of what's taught in the temple. But I'm afraid if I go to what I learned from the temple about God being material, that it could be offensive. But it's very clear in the temple that God does not hear prayer. There's a certain place in the temple movie where God needs to send Jesus to check on Adam, and then Jesus sends Peter, James, and John to check on Adam. And then when they come down to the earth and check on him, they're surprised at what they find, and then they report back up the ladder to God the Father, who, according to Mormon scripture, lives on a planet near the star Kolob, K-O-L-O-B. That actually is scripture. The other thing I would say about the racism in the polygamy, it would not be an issue in Mormonism if it was just a historical issue, but it's actually a scriptural issue. And I've pulled off of the LDS.org official website that the Mormon Church teaches that their scriptures are pure truth and they are utterly reliable. So if you have 26 scriptures that say dark skin is a curse, and you have this DNC 132 teaching that polygamy is an eternal principle, I don't know how the Mormon Church can say that they don't teach those things anymore. They are part of their doctrine because they're in their scriptures.
Do you want to respond to that, James?
So many things in there. It's difficult to know. I mean, I, without going into detail with regards to the temple and so forth, I have no doubt that God is able to hear my prayers. It's a similar argument to some extent that the Gnostics made against the earliest Christians, really, that there was this God that came down and said, Adam, where are you? And it was as though God didn't know. Now, God knew all of those things, and it was just for people's learning, and it's figurative and all of those things. So I have no doubt that God does hear my prayers, and that he hears everybody's prayers as well, and that he answers them in whatever way he sees fit or is part of his will.
Sure. And in the polygamy, she says it's not just a historical thing, that the racism and so on, it's part of the scriptures that, you know, Mormons live by today. What do you say?
Yes, with regards to the racism, I would say that because the scriptures are there that discuss the mark of Cain and different things, and I think what prophets have done recently and other people is they've talked about them in the sense that the mark was separation. The curse was separation from God. The mark was placed so that people separated from one another in the case of the Book of Mormon. So I would say that for those references, there are just as many references that say that all are alike unto God and that no one is denied anything through that. Now, I recognize that yes, this is fairly recent interpretations and different things, but I think, as we look back to Joseph Smith and others, those things were there. And with regards to polygamy, then yes, section 132 is still one of the scriptures. Mormons do not practice polygamy anymore in this life, and I know Lynn will come back with something on that. But it's the case that, yes, those are there, but if we were to delete those references, then that would in some ways kind of go away from where we've come from. And I think there are some very interesting discussions to have, and I think there's some learning to be made within those particular areas as well.
Just got a couple of minutes on this side of our first break, Lynn, but do you want to respond to anything that James said?
One of the major differences you have between the faiths is the God of Mormonism can change and does change his mind and kind of update with the culture. The God of the Bible got it right from the beginning, knew the end from the beginning, sees all things, is outside of time and space. And so you have an unchangeable God. And that was another one of the huge differences that made a difference to me when I began to read the Bible.
Look, we're going to come back to your story, Lynn, later on in the program, because we haven't really talked about the difference you found between the Mormon view and the biblical view of Jesus as well. So we'll do that towards the end of today's program. But for now, we're going to swap over shortly after a break to speaking to Corey Miller with his experience of leaving Mormonism. And he'll be in conversation with James in the second part of today's Unbelievable show. The book that we're talking about is Leaving Mormonism, Why Four Scholars Changed Their Minds. And you can find out about it at the website of today's program. I'm talking about Mormonism today and why Corey Miller and Lynn Wilder left Mormonism. We heard Lynn's story in the first part of today's program. We're going to hear Corey's story in this part of the program, telling their stories as well in the book Leaving Mormonism, Why Four Scholars Changed Their Minds. And in conversation with them, UK Mormon James Holt is with us as well. He's involved in academic research with the LDS Church. Just a reminder, if you're interested in today's show, you can hear it back at premierchristianradio.com/unbelievable. Loads more resources there if you're interested in apologetics, debates, discussions. Unbelievable, the book, Why After 10 Years of Talking with Atheists, I'm Still a Christian, available to read there as well. You can get a signed copy in time for Christmas. And indeed, lots of other resources, features, articles, the Unbelievable Conference on DVD, and so on. Today, after today's programme, you can also hear The Profile. Don't forget, that's between 4 and 5. Another Christian talking about their walk of faith and life here on Premier Christian Radio. Corey, let's come to you now. You were one of the contributors to this book, and your own story is one, as you said, where you were born into, effectively, the Mormon Church. You have ancestry that goes right back to Joseph Smith. So give us, and again, it'll have to be the brief version, the reason why you eventually actually left the church yourself.
Right. Well, my story's different from Lynn's because I grew up in Utah, grew up in Mormonism as a sixth, or I'm finding now possibly seventh generation Mormon. But I think I left the Mormon community before I left the Mormon God, the Mormon theology. And, you know, you can't judge a religion based on the mere experiences of what might be good or bad apples in that religion. But to be quite honest, I didn't have a lot of good experiences, and I felt there was a lot of hypocrisy. I didn't see grace. Nonetheless, I believed that Heavenly Father was my Heavenly Father, and I maintained that connection and relationship, I believed, to God. I never wanted to throw out God. And it was just, you know, communal issues growing up. When I had a chance to go outside of Utah and see a bigger world, I went to a Christian camp, not to go to the camp, but to spend this summer in California at the beaches. And the friend of mine, his father preconditioned it on us going to this camp, and I could spend the whole summer at the beaches. And when I was there, I remember the speaker talked about hell and sin. And frankly, I had never heard about hell depicted in this way, that the way that the Bible does, and frankly, the way that the Book of Mormon does, but is not talked about in Mormonism. And it really made me resonate with how sinful I really was as a sinner. It opened the door for the first time for me to really contemplate and understand grace. And when I saw the gospel with new eyes and a fresh look resonating in my heart that I needed Jesus, and now it was Jesus and not the church, which is always sort of emphasized, the church, the church, the church, even though Jesus is prominent in name and in ministry in the Book of Mormon. In Mormon conversations, it's about the church, the church, the church. When I saw Jesus the first time, this vision, and I saw it in people, it blew my mind away. I converted to Christ and had an existential encounter that I had never experienced. I lived in California with this family for my junior year of high school and fell in love with Jesus and his broader church that I now learned about, was learning from the Bible. When I came back to Utah my senior year of high school to graduate, that's when things became problematic. I was told that I could be a son of perdition, someone who knew the truth and left it, and asked if I wanted to re-investigate the Book of Mormon and read through it again. And I thought, yes, that's a scary future if I'm one of those apostates. And so I did, this time for the sake of truth rather than just tradition, because I had grown up traditionally as a Mormon. And now I really had a vested interest. My eternal destiny waited on this. And when I started reading it, for some reason, it now read differently. And I found it to be highly problematic in a number of ways. I began to see that my reasoning for leaving Mormonism was more grounded than a mere subjective encounter with Jesus, but that there were intellectual reasons to move away from Mormonism. And that, in turn, made me also start questioning the foundation of the Bible. I'd learned in Mormonism that we believe the Bible as far as it's translated correctly, and so that bit of doubt was always there. But now I started to move into skepticism, and how did I know that the Bible was true? How did I know that God existed? How do I know which God? How do I know I exist? And this is sort of what sent me into this trajectory of philosophy and comparative religions where I live and move in today. But as I continued down that road in comparative philosophy and religion, the evidence came pouring in, confirming the largest movement on the planet that has ever existed, the Jesus movement, historical Christianity, that it is true. And so my subjective encounter with Jesus matched up and corresponded with the objective encounter of the facts themselves.
Thank you for sharing your story, Corey. Obviously, you now work sort of in that whole realm you mentioned via Ratio Christi, and I'll make sure there are details as well to where people can find out more about that. But the specific issue you really develop in the course of your particular chapter is in the whole area of Mormon testimony. Now, I've encountered sometimes Mormons on the streets, and I do remember one of the encounters I had where they talked to me and said, look, if you just go and read the Mormon scriptures and see what happens, and if you feel a burning in your bosom, something, then you'll know that God is confirming that this is true. Now, is that what Mormons mean by the testimony, that they had some kind of a sense, a burning in the bosom, whatever it might be called, that confirms that the Mormon scriptures are true and that it is the way to God, as it were?
Sure. And to be clear, in my chapter, I focus on three things. One is on the Mormon concept of God, the other, the concept of salvation or salvations, and then the testimony. So, yes, this is in the field in philosophy called epistemology or theory of knowledge, there is a distinct epistemology for Mormons in terms of their religious knowledge. And growing up, you're taught to bear testimony, and you're taught to do it frequently. There are testimony meetings. One prophet that I used to sing songs about growing up, Spencer W. Kimball, talks about how you can lose merit points in heaven if you fail to bear testimony. And so what is this testimony? Well, if you go to a testimony meeting, if you hear LDS missionaries in your homes bear testimony, there is a common core that you're going to hear from most of them. And it's something like, I bear you my testimony. I know Joseph Smith is a prophet of God. I know the Book of Mormon is the Word of God. And I know that the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is the one true church. And they bear it with such tenacity that it's easy to confuse that with veracity or truth. And of course, tenacity does not entail veracity, as if the more emphatic you declare it, the more true it becomes. When it comes to understanding what is the nature of the Mormon testimony, yes, the burning in the bosom, the current apostle Dallin Oaks named it that, denotes it as that. Maybe he wasn't the first. He cites Doctrine and Covenants 9 and says that, you know, it's the burning in the bosom, which signifies a feeling of comfort and serenity. And it is this ecstatic feeling that many Mormons seek for. They long for. Boyd K. Packer, another apostle, said that, you know, testimony is to be found in the bearing of it. The more you bear it, it might come. It's a spiritual knowledge, as he says, the leap of faith, as philosophers call it. And it also says in Mormon publications that you read, you ponder, and you pray. And at the very end of the Book of Mormon, there is this promise, apparently, that Mormon missionaries like to give out in chapter 10, where it says, if you pray about these things, you will receive this truthful testimony. And Mormon prophets say that if people are honestly seeking, they will get it. Well, does that mean that if you don't get it, you're not honestly seeking? Or what about different Mormon sects that get it but contradict the Salt Lake sect? And so I've got a real concern with Mormon epistemology that seems so highly subjective that there should be little confidence in that as a sole criteria for truth.
Let me come to you then, James. James Holtz, our Mormon, on the program today here on Unbelievable. I mean, you have a testimony, James. You were converted as a 14-year-old. What do you describe it as? How do you know, in that sense, that Joseph Smith is the prophet of God, that the Book of Mormon is true, that the Mormon Church is the one true church, and so on? Just be interested in your account of how you knew that to be true.
Yeah, and I think in some ways I don't disagree with anything that Corey has said about the testimony and the description of it and everything else. But I think first and foremost, my testimony or my witness is that Jesus Christ is my Savior. He is the beginning, the end, the center, everything, and everything else kind of flows from him. And he is the center of my faith. And I think sometimes in church people talk about the other things, and I don't mean overlook Christ, but he's kind of implicit in everything that we do. So, but I would say that Christ is the first and the last and everything to me. And the testimony to me is a witness of the Holy Ghost that things are true, that Jesus Christ is my Savior, as Corey said, as Joseph Smith is a prophet, that the Book of Mormon is the Word of God. But I don't think that's an irrational faith. I think very much so I have a rational faith. He mentioned the Doctrine and Covenants, talks about the burning in the bosom. And that's just an analogy, really, for feeling the Holy Ghost. I've never In fact, when I joined the church, I was very worried that I'd never felt this burning in the bosom. I don't know what I was expecting, but feeling of calm, serenity, those types of things that told me that Jesus Christ was my Savior. And that same witness came through with regards to other things, and everything has its root in the Savior. But the Doctrine and Covenants also talks about how the Holy Ghost speaks to the heart and the mind. So it's not just an emotional response or a kind of almost imagined response. It's it makes sense in the mind and it feels good within the heart. And that's the testimony that I have. And that has developed over the years. My relationship with Christ, my closeness, my testimony has developed as I've had spiritual experiences, as I've served, as I've felt the grace of Christ within my own life and I've responded to that grace, then my testimony has also developed.
Right.
In some ways, testimony is a relationship with Christ and a knowledge of his dealings with
humanity. So, as you say, it doesn't preclude, obviously, a rational element to the faith. I mean, I've always assumed as well that the burning in the bosom thing, is that kind of coming, does that find its roots in the story in Acts when Jesus walks on the road to Emmaus with the two disciples, and as he opens the scriptures to them, they say, "Did not our hearts, you know, burn within us?" Is that the reference that the Mormon scriptures are sort of tied to in that sense?
I think so. I mean, I think it's in Luke, where in the resurrection appearance of that, but also the idea within Judaism of the Shekinah, which is the presence of the Lord is in both cloud and within flame. So I think fire and burning is a very well-known representation of the presence of God or the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Let me cross back to you, Corey. Firstly, one of the things James says is simply that whatever this thing is described as, this testimony, this burning in the bosom, whatever it might be, it doesn't preclude me having a rational faith. And in a way, I can see his point, because actually I think lots of Christians would also equally say that they know God is true, Christianity is true, because of some sort of witness of the Holy Spirit to them, alongside perhaps, you know, objective reasons which we can all look at as well.
Certainly, and I think a lot of Christians dismiss too easily the Mormon testimony. I did part of my dissertation work on the spiritual formation views of Thomas Aquinas, and the whole question about the knowledge of God. Jesus said, "Here is eternal life, to know God." It's incumbent upon us to know that we're children of God, Romans 8:16. We believe in revelation. We have testimonies. But when a Christian speaks about a testimony, it's not the same. We don't have that stock core that Mormons have. Ours is always about Jesus, how he transformed our lives at a time or through time. It's not about a church. It's not about a book or anything like that. But it also is not the sole criterion upon which our testimony rests. Our testimony rests on, the self-authenticating witness of God, but it's not just a leap of faith. It is a reasonable faith. It is a rational faith. Jesus is called the Logos in John 1, the logic. God is by nature rational as well as loving. Deuteronomy 13 and 18 give tests for a prophet. If a God concept is given and one claims to believe in that and that God doesn't exist, well, you can hardly say that that's a true belief that constitutes knowledge. Knowledge historically from Plato on was justified true belief. Mormons believe one thing, atheists believe one thing, Christians believe one thing. Whether it's true or not is another question, and then whether it's justified, whether it's intellectually warranted. And this is a key issue here, is that, in the Bible, you find Luke starting out his gospel talking about how he did a historical investigation. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says the whole of Christianity rests on the historical fact of the resurrection of Jesus. Romans 1 talks about natural theology. The book of Acts names various people and places and cities and things that can be corroborated with archaeology and things like that. When I look at the Mormon testimony, you know, having gone over to Israel and excavated archaeologically and found things 1,500 years old within an hour, and then I look up at the BYU campus in Israel and wonder, if those students are questioning their professors, because they have nothing like that with respect to the Book of Mormon. It's built almost entirely on, and it doesn't mean that Mormons aren't intellectual people, but when it comes to their religious epistemology, it's not corroborated with evidence. The Book of Mormon doesn't have the kind of evidence. The concept of God in Mormonism, and I teach comparative religions, is much closer to Hinduism than it is to Christianity, Judaism, or even Islam. They both cannot be true. And so, you know, when a Mormon prays and receives this feeling of comfort and serenity, it is very difficult to get that to correspond to the intellectual realities of logic, which I get into in my chapter, and of empirical evidence. You know, Mormonism says that there was a total apostasy, a total falling away from the truth, especially with respect to priestly authority. And then there was this restoration that Joseph Smith went into the forest, into the grove, and he prayed, and he received the revelation. And now Mormons today have a testimony that that testimony of Joseph Smith was true. The problem is, which version and which Mormon testimony? There have been over 400 Mormon sects, and even today there are probably 80.
Well,
and so they all give that stock phrase, and yet they contradict one another. What that means is, at best, only one of those 400, all with their own living apostles and prophets, can be true. The rest would be false, and maybe they're all false.
Let's give James a chance to respond to some of these, Corey, because you've raised a whole host of questions and so on at that point. James, let's come back to you, because I think that the question is, okay, you and many Mormons do say you have this experience, this testimony, but as far as Corey can see, whereas historic biblical Christianity, in his view, also talks about that, it is corroborated by the evidence as well, the objective evidence, and that's not the case with Mormonism. I mean, do you want to speak to any of these issues? And it's often the one that's brought up as the fact that there's very little, as far as we can see, evidence of the historical stuff that's claimed in the Book of Mormon and its history, whereas you go to, obviously, the Middle East, to Israel, and you'll find lots of elements that certainly tie the events down to a time and place. Do you want to start there and see where we go?
Yeah, I mean, the majority of what Corey said up until the book, so the rational faith, the understanding and all of those things, I completely agreed with, and I'm thinking, how on earth do I respond when I agree with everything that you've just said? But then the veracity of the Book of Mormon and those types of things, and yes, that there isn't the archaeological evidence and those types of things that there is for the Bible. To some extent. However, part of the thing is not just, and William James talked about this in his Varieties of Religious Experience. He says religious experiences, these testimonies, I suppose, from a Mormon perspective, have a noetic quality. That's what they have. And so it leaves an impression and it changes. So we know that Paul, for example, Saul, had his experience, and we know that it's real because of the impact that it had on his life. And so if I look at the impact that coming to know my Savior through the Book of Mormon has had on my life, I would say that's the testimony that I have, and kind of that's the veracity, if you like, for me, is the impact that it has, the closeness I feel to my Savior through a study of the Book of Mormon, through a study of the Bible as well. Kind of that's the most important thing,
but wasn't Paul
there may
also,
well, be evidence in the future,
yeah,
and so forth.
But wasn't Paul also, obviously, as well as having had that experience of meeting the risen Christ, also linked very much into the historical Christ himself through meeting his immediate followers, through them sharing the story of what happened, through living in the same place and meeting the people who met him? That, of course, isn't the case with Mormonism's story, as told in the Book of Mormon, that Joseph Smith told, because it was sort of at quite a remove from the events it purports to have happened.
Yes, I don't. But that's the same for any Christian today, is that we don't have the experiences with people who knew Jesus while he lived on this earth and all of those type of things. So the same kind of issues face any Christian who's trying to develop their faith in relationship to him.
Let's just pursue this a bit further with Corey and see what, yeah, go ahead, Corey.
Okay. I look at the outside corroborative evidence, though, and with respect to Jesus and his life and times, we have 45 different outside sources providing 129 independent literary facts, most of whose sources in the first, second, and third century are hostile to Christianity, and yet they corroborate and confirm those details or sometimes generalities of Christ. We've got that Holy Land sandbox of archaeology. So, you know, I bet James is an upstanding figure. I bet his religious experience, as William Lane, James would talk about, is a positive one somehow on his life. But there are virtuous atheists as well. It doesn't mean that Mormonism is true because a Mormon lives a virtuous life in thinking that it's connected to Mormonism. It doesn't mean that Christianity is true because of that. I want to know if it's true whether or not I even live a good or bad life. Christianity is either true or false, regardless of whether I live upstanding or not. And a question I might have for James, I'd be interested in his feedback on this. We are all here familiar with Joseph Smith's experience in the Grove, the restoration of the gospel, the priesthood, and Joseph Smith seeing a lot of diversity of Christian expression out there, Methodists and Presbyterians and so forth. He allegedly had a revelation that he was to restore the truth, and Mormons now go out and often bear testimony that this is the one true church and expression with the restoration. Well, what if James were to go out into the forest today and suddenly he comes upon three or four different current sects of Mormonism, representatives from those sects, each one of them contradicting one another? They all claim to know that the Book of Mormon is true, that Joseph Smith is a prophet of God, and that their Church of Jesus Christ is the one true church. My question is how does James, like Joseph Smith, wondering with all the diversity, how does he know which of those churches are true rather than his own church? And so as he follows up with this and responds, I would appreciate it if he would he say, because he believes that his Salt Lake City expression is true, that all of those other ones bearing testimony are lying? Is he judging their hearts as liars? Because they believe their testimonies and they believe their lifestyles are morally virtuous because of them.
Okay.
Or would he say that they're simply deceived based on a subjective testimony?
Just got a couple of minutes, so if you want to respond, James, and then we'll go to our final break.
Okay. Obviously, the way that I would find out the truth is the way that I find the truth. You study out in your mind, you take it to the Lord, and through the Holy Spirit, you know the Lord's will for you. Now, I can never judge anyone's heart. That's not my job. That's not my role. That is God's role alone. Are these people in error? Yes. But it may be that they're just on a different path, and that at some future point that they will receive the complete truth and all of those things. So it's not that people have necessarily been deceived, though they are in error, and it's just according to their knowledge they're living as best they can at the moment. But that's not to say that that knowledge can't be fulfilled or that they can receive the same witness that I've had. But I would say that answer always comes through the Holy Ghost, but having studied it out in our minds first and foremost.
We're going to go to another break, and we'll hear back from Corey and Lynn. We've been hearing about why Lynn Wilder and Corey Miller left Mormonism, as detailed in their new book, along with two other scholars, Leaving Mormonism. Engaging today with James Holt, a UK Mormon involved in academic research with the LDS Church. Do go onto the Unbelievable website to find out more about them. Links to the book and such. PremierChristianRadio.com/unbelievable. And we were hearing in that last segment the whole issue of testimony and James and Corey going over what counts and what, whether it needs to match up with some kind of historical objective evidence as well, Lynn. I mean, going back to how you began to doubt the Mormon Church, it was really through, in a sense, the testimony of your son, one of your sons, who came back from his mission trip and testified to Jesus rather than to the Mormon Church, as it were. Do you want to take us through that and how it links in with where you landed when it came to looking at the person of Jesus?
Micah was a leader on his mission, and he was asked to stand in front of 60, 80 other missionaries at the end of his mission and bear testimony of what he'd learned over the last 2 years. And of course, I said he'd been reading the Bible, said he read the New Testament probably a dozen times over. So he stood before these sweet missionaries crying, talking about Jesus bearing our sins on the cross. And his entire testimony to those Mormon missionaries was about Jesus and what Jesus had done for him and how the blood had covered him. Micah didn't have any Christians to talk to. He was only reading the Word. He was called in by his Mormon leader after this testimony and questioned about his faith. Why? Because he didn't start his testimony with, I know the church is true. I know Joseph Smith was a prophet. I know we have a living prophet today. I know the Book of Mormon is the Word of God. That's a Mormon testimony. All he did was bear testimony of Christ, and that was subject. He was actually, when he was questioned about his faith, and he said, I'm not sure I need the Mormon Church between myself, a living prophet between myself and God. I believe that I've been saved by grace. He was called an Antichrist and told he had the spirit of the devil in him, and he was sent home, and they tried to excommunicate him. That did start my journey, because I could not figure out why, if your testimony is of Jesus alone, that's such a problem for the Mormon Church. But I found out, as far as evidence, the Bible has linguistic evidence. Book of Mormon has none. Who ever heard of Reformed Egyptian? Historical evidence, 25,000 archaeological digs, botanical evidence, animal evidence, DNA evidence, doctrinal evidence that comes from both religious and secular sources. And that was overwhelming for me. The other thing about all this burning in the bosom stuff is I realized Christianity has evidence and reason and subjective experiences together. And Mormonism only has the subjective experiences.
Let's come back to you, James. So obviously what Lynn's saying her son had experienced was this, you know, this witness to Christ, she says, and that didn't stand up well when it came to those he was supposed to be reporting back to, because a Mormon is supposed to put the church in a sense first. But is that a characterization you agree with? Tell us what you think.
That's not a characterization I recognize within my own experiences, and I often bear testimony and share my beliefs that focus only on the Savior. And I don't mean to say the other things are an afterthought, but if they're included, then they're completely secondary to that. So I don't understand why people would respond that way, though I understand that they did. I don't understand why they would respond that way, because, as I said before, Jesus is the beginning, end, and everything to me. But, I mean, Lynn used a phrase there, which was, I don't need a church or a prophet to stand between me and my relationship with God. And I would agree. I think the church and the prophet and all of those people are there to help our relationship with God. But my relationship with God, my relationship with the Savior is a personal relationship. And the church, the Book of Mormon, all of those things help that relationship and strengthen it. That's not my experience, but I don't doubt that that happened at all. It's just very unfortunate that it did. And certainly in my congregation, I often hear testimonies that are purely about the Savior. Sometimes I hear the exact testimonies that Lynn has described, so I know the church is true and that comes first. But it's not a written down rule that there's a specific order. And if there was, then it, for me, it would be the Savior that came first.
Let's come across to you, Corey. Anything you want to add, and then we'll get Lynn to say something at the end as well.
Sure. And I think James has a good point about there being a sociology of Mormonism. My biggest concern is with the theology of Mormonism, and I'm grateful that he can put Jesus at the front and center. My concern is, however, that the Mormon description of Jesus is not the biblical description. When the Book of Mormon is subtitled Another Testament of Jesus Christ, it literally is a testament of another Jesus Christ. They are not the same. One was always God. The other became a God, like an infinite number of gods ahead of him. One provided means by which people can, if they live all the commandments all the time, receive that final grace to bring them into eternal life. But that's not the biblical concept of grace. And I would love to just quote this one section in 1 John that talks about the testimony. More than anywhere else in the Bible, it uses the term the testimony to see whether or not we really have the testimony. In 1 John 5, 9 through 13, it says, "If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For the testimony of God is this, that he has given concerning his Son. The one who believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. The one who does not has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony God has given concerning his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life," present tense in the Greek, "and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has the life. He who does not have the Son does not have the life." And then it says this final word, "These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, in order that you may know that you have eternal life." I can know today, yesterday, tomorrow, and a year from now that I have eternal life, the greatest of all gifts of God, and be assured of my salvation with Heavenly Father because of Jesus and him alone. I don't think James can have that testimony as a Mormon. He can have it, but not consistent with Mormonism.
What do you say, James?
I think I can say that as a Mormon and still be consistent. I believe I have salvation through Christ. I believe it's only through his grace that I can return and live with God. And it is salvation, and salvation is free. It's a gift of God. And I think certainly I can agree with what Corey has said, and I do think it is consistent. I think sometimes it hasn't been emphasized, and I don't think all the time it's been talked about, but I think that it is there, and the scriptures that Corey quoted, I obviously completely agree with, because they're scripture. But I do have salvation through Christ. I will return to God's presence, and I don't have a problem, and I don't think anybody in my church would have a problem with me saying that.
I
don't think it's always been emphasized.
I will redirect people as well to the last conversation you had on this program with Bill McKeever, when this was obviously very much around the issue we're discussing, the issue of grace in Mormonism and elsewhere. So, but let's perhaps finish with Lynn, because we are running out of time now. Lynn, where do you want to finish up as we conclude today's conversation?
We are missing the major point. The definition of eternal life in Mormonism is families living together with God. That requires works, it requires worthiness, and it is works-based salvation. To say that Jesus is enough only gets you to the second kingdom and not the highest kingdom in Mormonism. And yet, the Bible teaches something very different. I went face down and gave my life to Jesus when I read, "Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but is crossed over from death to life." I don't have to wait till the end of my life to see if I've done enough temple works.